Claude Shannon saw the world in ones and zeros, realizing they could represent words, sounds, images, even ideas. Computers don't actually understand the letters we type. Every keystroke is translated into a series of ones and zeros that the computer can process. These binary numbers could control electrical switches, including the billions of transistors packed inside a computer chip, powering all modern computing. Without Shannon's discoveries, computers as we know them wouldn't exist. Whether you're checking your email, visiting a website, or watching a video, we owe it all to Claude Shannon. As a kid growing up in Gaylord, Michigan in the 1920s, Shannon was already tinkering with technology. He turned a barbed-wired fence into a telegraph system, using the metal wire to carry electrical signals encoded in Morse code, an early glimpse into the idea of transmitting information. Getting into the family furniture business was not appealing to him. He had a mathematical mind and loved competing with his older sister, Catherine. Reflecting on his career decision, he once said, "I think one tends to get into work that you find easy for yourself." After finishing high school, he went on to study at the University of Michigan, earning degrees in both mathematics and electrical engineering because he wasn't sure what he liked best. At the time, math and electrical engineering were seen as two separate fields, but Shannon saw the connection. In mathematics, he learned about a system developed by British mathematician George Boole in the 1800s to analyze true or false statements using simple rules, known as Boolean logic. Imagine you're ordering a pizza with two toppings, pepperoni and mushrooms. If you apply Boolean logic to your decision, there are three possibilities. You only order the pizza if it has both pepperoni and mushrooms. You will only order the pizza if it has pepperoni or mushrooms. You will not order the pizza if it has mushrooms. Each decision follows a simple yes or no rule represented by ones, yes you order, and zeros, for no you do not. Shannon realized this same Boolean logic applied to electrical circuits. In a circuit, one on means a switch is closed, allowing electricity to flow, and zero off means the switch is open, stopping electricity flow. For the AND logic gate, the light turns on only if both switches are on. For the OR gate, the light turns on if at least one switch is on. The NOT gate flips the state of exactly one input, in this example, switch B. If switch B is off, the NOT output is on. If switch B is on, the NOT output is off. AND, OR, and NOT are the fundamental building blocks of computers. By combining these basic logic gates in different ways, we can build complex circuits that perform calculations, store data, and execute instructions that form the core of modern computing.
Shannon could have, if he had wanted, become unbelievably famous. We could probably speak of him in the same breath as an Einstein. He could have been a scientific celebrity.
I spoke with Jimmy Soni, co-author of a biography about Shannon called A Mind at Play.
I was like, there should be a book. Like, this person is a hugely consequential figure. There are books about Einstein. There are books about Feynman. There should be a book about Shannon.
Shannon's breakthrough didn't happen overnight. In the spring of 1936, while at the University of Michigan, he spotted a job posting on a bulletin board inviting students to help build a mechanical brain at MIT. He later recalled, "I pushed hard for that job and got it. That was one of the luckiest things in my life." Vannevar Bush, one of the most powerful scientists in America, saw Shannon's potential and hired him to work on his differential analyzer, one of the earliest mechanical computers that relied on gears, wheels, and rotating shafts to solve equations in calculus.
He's in this like gray room with this giant machine at all hours. The thing breaks down all the time, so he's responsible for like fixing it and keeping it up. So it's not like the most glamorous work.
Although the work wasn't glamorous, it led to his greatest insight. Shannon saw firsthand that the gears and wheels were slow, prone to errors, and required constant manual adjustments. After solving one equation, an operator had to manually reset the gears before the machine could solve the next. So he started thinking, what if there was a better way? Instead of clunky mechanical parts, what if flipping electrical switches could do the job? In 1937, Shannon wrote a master's thesis that changed the world, what Harvard University professor Howard Gardner called possibly the most important and also the most famous master's thesis of the century. He proved that any circuit, no matter how complex, could be represented by a set of equations. He took Boolean algebra and applied it to circuit design, proving that logical operations could be executed automatically using electrical switches.
It was the first time that anybody had made that kind of direct connection, and it kind of opened the door to a different way to design circuits.
Before Shannon, circuit design was inefficient, built in an ad hoc way. engineers wired circuits for specific tasks without a standard method to optimize or simplify them. Shannon's work changed that forever. At MIT, word quickly spread about the young man from Michigan. His flight instructor refused to teach him to fly propeller planes, not wanting to risk losing a brain like his, but MIT's president overruled the decision. Shannon's brilliance extended beyond circuits. Vannevar Bush encouraged him to explore population genetics for his PhD thesis, which uses math to predict how genes are passed down through generations. Despite having no background in genetics, he quickly mastered the field, even developing a formula to predict how frequently any three alleles would appear in a population over time. Genetics would only be a short detour. When Shannon wrote to Bush for career advice, Bush was certain his calling lay in applying mathematics to real-world problems. "The only point I have in mind is I feel that you are primarily an applied mathematician, and that hence your problem ought to lie in this exceedingly broad field rather than in some field of pure mathematics." Shannon took his advice seriously, spending two summers at Bell Labs, the research arm of the telephone company where scientists built the future, and also a fellowship at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton. But then came the draft. Shannon grew nervous about being sent off to fight in the World War, but he saw the writing on the wall. "I could smell the war coming along, and it seems to me I would be safer working full-time for the war effort, safer against the draft, which I didn't exactly fancy. I was a frail man, as I am now. But not only that, I thought I'd probably contribute a hell of a lot more." He felt his greatest contribution wouldn't be on the battlefield, but in the lab. His mentor at Bell Labs, Thornton Fry, secured him a contract with the National Defense Research Committee, where he helped design machines during the war to shoot down enemy planes, critical in defending England during the Blitz. His work impressed Fry, who hired him as a full-time research mathematician at Bell Labs. It was a huge relief for Shannon, who had felt not only the pressure of war, but also pressure in his personal life. He had married Norma Lavore, a liberal arts student, after 3 months of dating, but besides their love of jazz and shared atheism, they had little in common and soon divorced. Shannon's mental and emotional health suffered, as a senior figure at the National Defense Research Committee later recalled. "For a time, it looks as though he might completely crack up nervously and emotionally. It is Thornton Fry who deserves the primary credit for getting him out of that state and for offering him work in the Bell Laboratories. The rest of it is history."
"Hello, I'm Claude Shannon, a mathematician here at the Bell Telephone Laboratories."
One of the most critical projects he worked on at Bell Labs was SIGSALY, a speech scrambling system used by President Roosevelt and Prime Minister Churchill to prevent the Nazis from eavesdropping. It worked by scrambling Roosevelt's voice with a random noise key recorded on a vinyl record so that anyone intercepting the signal heard only static. At Churchill's end, the SIGSALY machine with an identical vinyl record subtracted the noise, restoring Roosevelt's voice. Since each noise key was used only once and destroyed, SIGSALY was mathematically unbreakable, a fact confirmed by Britain's top cryptographer Alan Turing during a visit to the US. Turing had proposed the idea of a universal machine, one that could, in theory, solve any mathematical problem that could be described algorithmically. Shannon realized that for such a machine to reach its potential, fundamental questions had to be answered. What exactly is information? Can it be quantified? Those questions led to his groundbreaking 1948 paper on information theory. Shannon's core insight was that all information, text, sound, images, could be reduced to binary digits, bits, and transmitted efficiently even over noisy channels. To combat errors caused by noise, he introduced redundancy techniques, adding extra bits so that even if part of the data was lost or corrupted, the receiver could still reconstruct the original message.
And all of a sudden people recognize, wow, this is like a whole new science now. The study of information, which up to this point was a bit ethereal, it was a bit fuzzy, is now something that you can like fit out for hard science. And that's when things really take off for him.
By the 1960s, Shannon had become a celebrity scientist. Yet, unlike Einstein and Oppenheimer, he tried to avoid the spotlight, regularly turning down media interviews or ignoring them altogether.
There's this amazing moment in researching the book where we discovered that he had a folder on his desk, and it was like all of these invitations, and it was like on the folder was written like, "Letters I've procrastinated too long in responding to. Here is the person who establishes the field that allows us to like have information disseminated around the world." And yet he has zero interest in like disseminating information about himself around the world.
He even wrote an article warning information theory was being overhyped. It has received an extraordinary amount of publicity. It has perhaps been ballooned to an importance beyond its actual accomplishments. He worried that his information theory would turn into a buzzword misused by those who didn't understand it. While he stepped back from the spotlight, he devoted more time to his personal life. At Bell Labs, he met an analyst named Betty Moore, who supported his quirky hobbies, including his obsession with unicycle riding. They had three children and settled in Winchester, Massachusetts, when Shannon became a professor at MIT, joining the electrical engineering and mathematics departments.
This is Theseus. Theseus is an electrically controlled mouse.
Although nothing would ever top his 1948 paper, he explored new and intriguing ideas. He built an electric mouse that navigated a maze through trial and error, using a small magnet inside the mouse to interact with the one beneath the maze. When Theseus bumped into a wall, his copper whiskers sensed the obstacle, triggering relays that adjusted his path. Over time, the maze's memory system recorded which routes led to dead ends and which led to the prize, the cheese. In other words, Theseus could learn from experience. This early form of machine learning foreshadowed developments in artificial intelligence.
I confidently expect that within a matter of 10 or 15 years, something will emerge from the laboratories which is not too far from the robot of science fiction fame.
Shannon envisioned a future where machines could truly think. He saw chess as a testbed for artificial intelligence, publishing a paper in 1950 describing how computers could strategize to beat humans, foreshadowing the strategies that eventually led IBM's Deep Blue to defeat chess grandmaster Garry Kasparov in 1997. Shannon's curiosity wasn't confined to computers. He loved juggling. Actually, he was a bit obsessed with it and wrote a paper about the mathematics of juggling. He once suspended an MIT student upside down to see if this could merge toss juggling with bounce juggling. The balls ended up falling to the floor. He also applied math to the stock market, devising a strategy of making constant small trades to profit from fluctuations, even if a stock's value declined. But by the 1980s, his brilliant mind began to betray him. He started to forget names and familiar faces. In a heartbreaking moment recounted by Jimmy Sunny and Rob Goodman in their book, A Mind at Play, Shannon's daughter Peggy recalled that when MIT's juggling club visited their home, he looked at her for a long time before asking, "Do you juggle?" Peggy said, "I was just floored. Is it that he doesn't know who I am or that he doesn't remember that I juggle?" Either one of them would be totally devastating. In 1983, Shannon was diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease, an irony almost too cruel to comprehend. The man who had built an entire theory ensuring that information could never be lost was now losing the information within his own mind. In 1993, after breaking his hip, his wife Betty, who was getting older herself, made the difficult decision to move him to a nursing center 3 miles from their home in Winchester. She visited him twice a day, every day. As his mind slipped further away, Shannon was unaware of the technological revolutions unfolding, built upon the foundation of his ideas. By the 1990s, engineers began inching closer to the Shannon limit, the maximum speed at which information can be transmitted error-free over a noisy channel, as defined by Shannon. Claude Shannon passed away on February 24, 2001. He was 84 years old. His brain was donated to Alzheimer's research in the hopes that future generations might better understand the disease and be spared the same fate. His core insight that information could be reduced to bits and transmitted reliably underpins every form of modern communication. His legacy is woven into the fabric of our digital world, bit by bit. Shannon's breakthroughs wouldn't have been possible without a strong foundation in math and science, the same kind of foundation you can build with Boolean. If you're curious about the physics behind electricity, Brilliant Circuits courses lets you explore how electrical systems work. You're not just watching lessons, you're actively solving problems that help you truly understand the mechanics behind machines. If you want to strengthen your logical reasoning and problem-solving skills, Brilliant's math courses cover everything from algebra and calculus to vectors. Or you can explore related fields like computer science, data science, and AI. You can start programming with Python on day one with their built-in drag-and-drop editor. One of my personal favorites is how large language models work, which gives a fascinating behind-the-scenes look at the technology powering tools like ChatGPT. And the best part is you can try Brilliant for free for 30 days by signing up using my link in the description, brilliant.org/newsthink, or scan the QR code on your screen. That's brilliant.org/newsthink for a free 30-day trial, plus you'll save 20% on your annual premium subscription, unlocking all of Brilliant's lessons. Thanks for watching. For Newsthink, I'm Cindy Pom.